Indeedy. Welcome to the Upful LIFE Podcast. I'm your host, B. Getz, and this is episode number 27. Coming at you live and direct from the Vibe Junkie Studios out here in Oakland, California. And let me tell you, we got a big one for you. And we're so grateful you're tuning in. The Upful LIFE Podcast, and it's a doozy, let me tell you. Appreciate everyone checking in after episode 26 with Ryan Jalbert of the Motet. Thanks to Ryan for coming on the show. I want to shout out our good friends at Nugs.net. Now, Nugs.net's been in the game of online music sharing, distribution, broadcasting, streaming since the beginning, and their visionary at the head of Nugs.net is a fellow named Brad Searling, and just a really fascinating dude who has built just a wonderful enterprise with what Nugs.net. Of course, you can get a gazillion bands' live shows through subscribing to their service. They are behind what broadcasts Live Fish. They do a number of free streams on the net on a weekly basis. And, just really awesome stewards of the culture in really forward-thinking ways, delivering the music and the art and the experience to you through technology, and an appreciation for what got us here. And you can check out Brad on an amazing episode of Under the Scales podcast with Tom Marshall, which brings me to the Nugs.net release their top podcasts in the jam band world, if you will, top jam band podcasts, and they were kind enough to include the Upful LIFE Podcast. So you can check that out on Nugs.net's website and in their newsletter. I put it on our socials, and it was just a real honor and touched my soul to be received in such a way. And I know I'm kind of hard on the quote-unquote jam bands, but obviously that's the culture that made me. I'm a deadhead, I love the Fish, and I worked for Jam Bass for years. I'm with Live for Live Music currently, so I wear it as a badge of honor. And as Adam Shmin Smirnoff said on this very show, the term jam band speaks a lot more to the audience and the community that supports the music than to a genre or style of music being performed on stage. And I am inclined to agree and tip my hat to Shmeens for that wisdom. And with that, we'll wrap up this this thank you to nugs.net. So check them out. And I would advise, if you have the means, to subscribe, because they offer a fantastic service and really just awesome folks over there at nugs.net. And you just heard the Black Crowes, Feeling All Right, from the joint at the Hard Rock in Vegas back in December of 96. And now we're going to hop, skip, and jump to the High as the Moon tour. Take a moment to shout out the winner of last episode's contest for VI Jam down there in the Virgin Islands, St. John. And the winner is Lauren Strickland. Lauren Strickland was one of about a dozen folks to enter the contest. And she lives down there. She's going to go to the show. She's going to bring her husband, Tucker. So shout out to the Stricklands and for everyone who supported that sponsored contest from VI Jam and my man Mo Angelo down there. And stay tuned for more collaborations between he and I, because go way back, Swanee fam, bringing it full circle. And want to let folks know real quick some cool shit that's happened since I last put an episode out. Did a deep dive on one of my, probably my all-time favorite album, D'Angelo Voodoo. 20 years ago it came out, January 25th, 2000. So I did a really deep dive, as did many music publications, but could not deny the opportunity to go there. So check that out on upfullife.com. It's called My Redeemer, a love letter to D'Angelo for 20 years of voodoo. Also, checked out an Atlanta hip-hop group called Earth Gang from the Spillage Village Collective and Dreamville Squad, if you will. They came through with Mick Jenkins. They played the Fillmore in SF, so hit the show, did a quick story. You can find that on Up Full Life and Live for Live Music. As you can, my interview with New Orleans' own vinyl DJ, the Queen of Rare Groove herself, DJ Soul Sister. So, yeah. Did a sweet interview with her on the phone in advance of her appearance at Denver Comes Alive. Shout out to Kunj and Sarah and everyone at Live for Live Music for the success of Denver Comes Alive's first annual. Went down last week. The Mission Ballroom, brand new venue out there, and they crushed it. So check out the different video footage that's coming out from that stream, because it's a pretty fantastic event. Always like to shout out the fam at Live for Live Music. And just want to send this episode out to one of my biggest inspirations, and that's a fellow named Dennis Cook. Dennis Cook was my editor at Jambase for years. He's one of the probably the foremost Black Crowes historical scholar and writer. I would liken his relationship and perspective to the Crowes to my own with lettuce. He's a friend to the band for years. He's written liner notes for them. I met him through the Black Crowes online community. And like I said, I put him next to like David Fricke and Hunter S. Thompson as like the most influential writers of my life. He inspired me to do this. He showed me how to get inside the music. He remains a trusted and dear friend and colleague. And though he's not as active as a writer as he once was, he still from time to time puts pen to paper and will bust out some really wonderful stuff. So I wanted to send this episode out to my man Dennis Cook down there in Santa Cruz. You know, he's still doing the damn thing. You know, he struggles with some depression, and he's been very open about that on social media. And that's kind of given me a greater understanding of what that's all about, too. And he also has an autistic son that he's a full-time stay-at-home dad to. So, Dennis, if you're out there listening, I love you. Your words have gone so deep and so far into so many of our lives. The musicians themselves, the readers, fans, and, of course, writers like myself. I still dig up your stuff when I'm looking for inspiration or for another way to get inside the music. And naturally, on a day like today, when I am welcoming the great Steve Gorman, founder and ex-drummer of the Black Crowes, to this show, I just wanted to take a few minutes and tell the world and you how much you influence me. And how much you mean to so many of us as a writer and just as a dude. So, I don't know if you listen to the show, but if you hear this, I love you. And with that, I'm going to play a little bit more Crowes here. This is from the March of 95 Beacon Theater run. Legendary run of shows with the Crowes. One of the many times they almost broke up, you know, etc. Steve Gorman, the reason that he is coming on the show and the reason that he invited me to host this book talk was because he wrote a book about the Black Crowes called Hard to Handle, The Life and Death of the Black Crowes, a Memoir. And what you're about to hear is a sit down with me and Steve in a live audience at Book Passage at the San Francisco Ferry Building in San Francisco. It happened on the day of the AFC Championship, or AFC and NFC Championship games, but Steve is a diehard Titans fan. They lost literally like 10 minutes before we sat down to do this. You'll hear him joke about it a little bit in the beginning. I think I want to play a little bit of Crowes here, and then I'm going to come back and set the stage for the interview. Yeah, Steve and I sat down with this live studio audience, if you will. It wasn't a studio, it was a bookstore, but just came out that way. Anyway, it was an honor and a privilege on a level that I have not the words for this dude to hit me up and be like, hey, would you come and interview me and host my book talk? Now, it's a relatively innocuous request, and it was only like 25-ish people that arrived and sat down, and maybe, you know, two-thirds of them stayed for the whole thing. Nonetheless, this is fucking Steve Gorman, drummer of the Black Crowes, who just wrote this, like, atomic bomb of a rock and roll memoir. It's on the Mount Rushmore of any that I've ever read, and I'm not just saying this because he asked me to do this. He might have asked me to do this because I felt this way about the book and wasn't shy about it on social media. Now, it's a controversial book. It leaves few stones unturned. He is very, very frank, and as he said, he wants to correct the false narratives that were parroted to the fans for so many years, and with that, a lot of the magic, a lot of the mystic, a lot of the just that thing that makes the music so special and so authentic to us, a little bit of that sheen comes off with this book, and we discuss that among a number of other topics. Now, I didn't really get to conduct, quote, my interview. I hope to have Steve on the show, like, for real one day. This was for his book, and he kind of just ran with it. I just kind of fed him some story ideas and some questions, and he answered them and took them where he saw fit. We did, like, 40 minutes, just me and him. I opened it up to some questions from the audience, and then I would sort of interject after those questions went to certain places that I had other questions for. So I was super prepared for this. I was very nervous. All the things. It was just such a, honestly, life highlight to just do this. Forget the podcast or the video that you'll see on YouTube. To just sit down with fucking Steve Gorman and talk about his career, and I'm a writer, and we're talking about his book and how he created this document of rock and roll history. And say what you will about the Crows, and now with this book and what's in there, you can talk a lot of shit. But at the end of the day, the music does the loudest and longest and most profound talking. And you really, no amount of you know, skeletons in the proverbial closet can take that away. So I want to just prep everyone. The sound is not ideal. We had initially planned to record it with the microphones, and Steve's just bombastic baritone voice need not amplification. So you're hearing us in a sort of cavernous bookstore. You'll hear some folks moving around, some tables and such. I did the best I could, in essence, to sort of tweak it and tighten it up and noise reduction, etc. And I hope that you guys can get past a little bit of the sound imperfections just to absorb the gems and jewels that Steve Gorman blesses us with for roughly an hour 20. Now, he's been on a gang of podcasts, including Brian Koppelman's show and Let There Be Talk with Dean Del Rey. I highly recommend State of Amorica, especially Steve's episode. But this is my episode and your episode and the Upful Life's episode and SF Book Passage episode. So we're going to defer back to that Beacon Theater show and hear Mark Ford and Chris Robinson sing us back home for a few moments. And then I'm going to play the interview with Steve Gorman, founder, ex-drummer of the Black Crows.
Football day, especially Steve here. It's an honor and a privilege.
It's a shitty football day. As a Titans fan.
So. Hoping that your team would pull it through so you'd be in a festive mood, but nonetheless, we're happy that you're here.
Listen, if it was a close game, I wouldn't be here. So thank the Chiefs for this happening on time. I'm not going to use this.
You don't need it.
Unless I need it.
Right on. Well, we all know the occasion is your memoir, Hard to Handle, Life and Death of the Black Crows, a memoir, and I gotta say, I read it in 1 7-hour sitting. I read it again. I listened to the audiobook. It's a fascinating tale.
I find the fifth time through is when it really connects.
Just, I had to let it all sink in.
I understand.
nonetheless, grateful for you to sit down with us, talk with us today. And there's so much in the book that we could discuss, and I just try to pick out a few of my favorite passages. One of the things that you start off talking about a little bit is that you were an air drummer for the first 10 years of your career, and you didn't buy a drum set until you were in your early 20s. Mm-hmm. 3 months later, you're in the studio recording an album that's going to go sell millions of copies. You're all over MTV.
Well, 3 months later, I was recording a demo that led to that. It was 2 years before we made the record. So.
Well,
it wasn't that fast.
Nonetheless, it was pretty instant success.
Yeah, pretty much.
How was that a gift and a curse in your career, to have it all so fast, so soon?
Yeah. Well, the drumming part was, it was great that I didn't start till I was so late, because I spent so much time thinking about it, and I always felt like I didn't have time to fuck up. I had to do it, you know, I was behind the eight ball. Like, at 21 to start playing drums, I thought, like, I'm so late to the dance, I can't screw anything up. So I was sort of obsessed with not being great, but just not sucking. I mean, that was really my goal. So, that played a large part of why I fit in. The band came together pretty quickly because I was just making sure not to screw anything up. Like, it's always going to be at least solid, and that helped with that. And then as far as for the band, you know, it's funny because it didn't feel like it went quickly. Those 3 years from buying the kit to the record coming out, they felt like 30 years, what it would feel like now, you know, because every week, every day, wondering about, you know, I wonder what's going to happen for lunch today. You know, I mean, no one has a nickel, and you're just having a lot of fun, but not also seeing any path, developing at first. And we had a lot of frustrating things happen, like any local band does. And plus, we sucked. I mean, I thought we had this great chemistry, and I felt like we were. I used to say we're the worst band in Atlanta and the best band in the world, and I thought both those things were very true. Because every band in the Atlanta scene in the late 80s was better than Mr. Groh's Garden. But I could just see that we had something they didn't. And maybe that was just blind arrogance, but it was whatever it was there. And so all that stuff led to, but then as far as the first record being successful or all that too fat, yeah, I mean, that's a classic story. If you just lose perspective pretty quick, or the first time out, you have such a big hit.
Right, and it had a long life, that record. You toured for a long time behind it. There were lots of videos behind it.
Yeah.
It was a different day and age. What was that experience like, just becoming a rock band that everyone would point you out in the mall and know who you were, and rubbing shoulders with Aerosmith and Arenas?
I mean, at the time, it made sense. You know, nothing happened. I mean, I always look at, like, Nirvana. They put their record out, and it was number one, like, in 3 weeks, you know what I mean? And we had a year before our record. Back then, you know, went platinum, which, that's unbelievable, my records now, but back then, a lot of bands did that. You'd have one shot at it, and a lot of bands sold a million records. It sounds so weird to say now, but it took a year to do that, and we were, blessing and a curse, so self-absorbed at all times. We were just really trying to be a great band. You know, we just felt like we had made a record that we had to catch up to and be as good as. And so we really, to our credit, we focused on being a really great live band more than anything else. And so by the time it was obvious that it was a big hit and all that, we as excited as we probably all were, we never admitted it or even shared it with ourselves. We just stayed focused on, well, you know, we were really chasing, like, you know, the ghost of the 72 Stones more than wondering what other bands of our own. We didn't care about our parents, you know. It was pretty insular mindset.
And you had stated that, you know, even though you were kind of coming from the Stones mold, if you will, that REM was the band that really turned you on.
Yeah. Well, for me, that's the band that made me want to play music. You know, like, I mean, it sounds like I'm knocking them, but I first saw REM I was in 11th grade, and I saw them at the Vanderbilt University Student Center. And first time I'd seen some arena shows, but I hadn't, you know, I wasn't old enough to go to clubs yet. I didn't see bands in small rooms. And the first time it was, you know, not that much bigger than this room. And it's the first time I realized, like, you just start here. Like, you just, and they weren't that great. They were cool and very unique, but I could tell, well, they're not, like, great. You know, they just have a vibe, but it's not like they were playing crazy things. You know, it just sort of, and then when I started seeing bands at clubs, it all fell in, like, oh, you just get some friends and try to figure this out and see if it works. But I was so into them early on, and everything their interviews, everything I knew about them, it just made sense to me and made me think, yeah, I need to do this, you know. I mean, I always wanted to do it, but I just didn't see a path, because how do you grow up a Beatles fan and think I'm going to do that. I mean, to me, in a small town in Kentucky, it just didn't make sense. Like, I would talk about playing in a band, and my friends would just look at me and go, okay, sure, yeah, whatever, dude. You know, I didn't have anybody that wanted to do it with me.
So you just basically played the one Bee Gees record that you had to, your brothers gave you some Beatles records, and then...
That was early on, yeah.
So Ringo was the guy.
Oh, yeah, always still.
Talk a little bit about what was it about Ringo Starr, the drummer, or the Beatles that you know, connected with you, young Steve, who didn't have anyone to share it with?
They have good songs. Call Me Crazy. His swing, it's just his feel. You know, the drummer, my favorite drummers all just have a unique swing. You know, they have their own sense of time. And he always served the song. And, I mean, I still listen to Beatles records and still think, how in the hell is he doing that? You know, the better I got, the better he got. You know what I mean? Like, we started off and, you know, like, it's just like anything else. I mean, a lot of musicians are that way, but he was my first guy that I just jumped on. And the more you learn about making records, the more you learn about writing songs, the more you learn about everything, the Beatles just got better and better and better. And I was like, this is weird. I kept thinking I was going to crack the code, and it's like, no, they just keep eluding it. Other bands are that way, too. You know, Little Feet, you know, the more you dig in and start really listening, you're just going, oh, fuck it, how did this, yeah. And so that's a great place to be, though, because there's not really a finish line in music. You just keep trying to learn and learn and learn, and then one day you die.
I feel like your records, a lot of them, you know, have that kind of replay value and sort of diamonds in the rough that you discover years and years and years later listening to.
Yeah, I hope so. I mean, that's what we're
doing. That's what I was
going for. Yeah.
And speaking of Ringo, I know I talked a little bit about, not in the book, but it's on the podcast, we had an opportunity to play music with Ringo and almost missed the chance. And then swing at it. How did that go?
Just this past summer, Ringo was touring. I live in Nashville. And went to see him, and I know his drummer, Greg Bissonette, and I know Ringo, which is weird to say, but you know, we're buddies. And so I went to see the show, and I brought my son down, and he met him, and it was really kind of cool for him. And they always, Ringo's shows always end with a little help from my friends. And he used to have drummers get up and sit in with the band. Like, Ringo has his kit, and then he goes up front and sings. And so then his kit's always empty when he's up front. But for a little help from my friends, he used to have people sit in. And like 5 years ago, I don't know who it was, but someone got up there and just blew it, just screwed the song up, and then Ringo said, no more drummers, so it's off. They don't do that anymore, and I've known that for years. So I went to the show not thinking anything about it, and we were talking before the show, quick chat in the hallway, and as he was walking to the stage, he said over his shoulder something like, blah, 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 you know, and I didn't really hear him because I'm half deaf, and I laughed and said something. It was just all whatever banter, and my son and I go out and we watch the show. It was a great gig. And the next morning I get up and his drummer Greg and then Steve Lucas, the guitar player, they both texted and they were like, dude, where were you? For a little help from my friends. I'm reading texts and I'm like, what are you talking about? And they said, Ringo asked you to sit in. And I was staring at my phone and I was like, I called Greg and I go, why are you doing this to me? He goes, dude, that's what he said. He said, hop up for a little help and keep your eye on Greg. And I heard him say something about Greg and I remember saying like, oh, I never turned my back on Greg. I don't trust that. But, you know, we're like, I thought it was all just shtick. And I'm staring at the phone, and he goes, yeah, we got off stage. And Ringo goes, whoa, I've been snubbed. And I was like in a blind panic. And I just was, I mean, I was really, it was a Friday, and it really upset me. Like, I couldn't shake it all day because, you know, I'm just like, well, that's not going to happen again. That would have been pretty awesome to do once in my life, you know, and so that was on a Friday, and then the following Wednesday, I had to go to Philadelphia for the day, I have a radio show, and I was meeting these guys with the network, and we were putting stuff together, and they were in Philly, so I was flying to Philly, and I have a buddy up there who is a promoter, a Live Nation promoter, and I just texted him, I said, hey, I'm in town Wednesday night, you got any gigs? And he just wrote back, yeah, Ringo. I was like, what the fuck? And so then I told Gray, I said, hey, I'm coming to the show. I'm not trying to barge in again, but I am going to be there again, you know. And I walked in the door in Philly, in the back door, and I got to the stage door, and I walked in, and right away his tour manager goes, upstairs, let's go. And he takes me up to Ringo's dressing room, and I walk in, and the first thing he says is, oh. And And I've known Ringo for a long time, but we've never had a lot of one-on-one time because not too many people do with him. It's always an event or it's a place or you hang in at dinner or whatever. And we just sat in his dressing room for a while, and he started, first time, it was the longest I've ever had with him, like one-on-one. And he was telling me all these fucking crazy Bonzo and Keith Moon stories, and I'm just sitting there like, you know, my brain melting. And at the very end, he goes, "So, are you gonna come up again tonight, or are you gonna snub me again?" You know, and I'm just like, can't believe Ringo's breaking my balls. I said, "No, I will be there." And he goes, "Well, do you know the song Photograph?" And I said, "Yeah, that's the first 45 I ever bought with my own money." And he goes, "Well, when you hear that one, come up to stage left, and then we'll get up and we'll do the song." And I was like, "Cool, I can do that." And then, and so it was great. He said, "All right, we'll see you after. You know, I'll see you up there. Have fun. You know, don't ruin it for everybody." I said, "Great." So I left. And I was really excited and I was thrilled I got to redeem myself. But then when Photograph started, I was on the side of the stage and I started having like an anxiety attack. I really was like, I'm going to get up and play Ringo's drums with Ringo. I mean, it was freaking me out. Like, this goes back to me at 6, like hearing Tickets Arrive for the first time and this being my lifelong guy. And it's one thing to meet him and hang out with him, but to play and be on his stage, I mean, that was a whole different thing. So it was... I was literally standing there going, like, and his tech came over to hand me some sticks, and he's like, "You cool?" And I was like, "Man, I'm kind of freaking out." I was really surprised by that. And I was losing my mind until I got up there. And once I started the kid, it was like, "Oh, okay. This is the easy part." It was the build-up. But we played the song, and I didn't ruin it, and I, you know, it was all good. Kind of went by in a blur, and so now I can die.
Glad you got the mulligan, because I would have.
It was a long weekend. Wondering if he was gonna ever talk to me again.
It's a lot of shows played, obviously with the Crows, and a lot of beers drank, as you noted in the book. And I was curious, how did you go about recounting with such detail these adventures and journeys around the world with the band and all these different cities who came and went? How do you go back and
it's a
get all
curse. I just remember everything. I mean, I don't have a photographic memory, I don't think. I mean, I know people that do, and I don't remember that kind of detail. But I have, as things were going along, there were always just significant moments, good, bad, and in the middle of everything, that were always just, they just found their way in, you know. And I mean, I wrote about 3 times what the book is, and the whole time I was writing it, all I thought was I'm leaving so much out. Like, I just kept saying, like, God, this is it. And it's like, to dive back in, I kept finding that, like, if I was telling a story or there's significant, the way I saw it in my head, I'd be writing about something, and my memory, it's like you walk into a room and there's 10 doors, and I'm like, oh shit, well, which one do I open? And then you go down, and then there's 10 more doors, and it's like, everything that comes back leads farther, deeper into the story. You know, like I can remember what everybody's wearing, what people were eating, and you know what it smelled like for a lot of, you know, all that stuff. And it's weird. It's just, you know, it was kind of exhausting. There were days when I would finish writing, I just was like dead. You know, I couldn't even think for 2 straight days. But I enjoyed it. I liked just being in a zone where there's no distractions. But yeah, I've had that kind of memory. So. Until my kids were born. It's gotten a little fuzzy. Yeah. That shy. I missed a few years in the early, you know, 2000 and 2005 is a bit of a blur. But once they could walk and talk on their own, I started, you know, I could check back into the real world.
The irony there is those are the years you were not active with the Crows.
For the most part, yeah.
Interesting. You know, when you moved on to the second album, Southern Harmony Musical Companion, timeless record, addition of 2 essential members to the band, the late great Ed Harsh on the piano and keys, yep, and Mark Ford on guitar. You dedicate a whole chapter to Ed, and a lot of really touching profiles of all the band members, Mark included. What was the difference? What ratcheted things up a notch when those guys got in the band?
Well, the biggest difference. And it's weird because this is it's not to take away anything from them. The biggest difference from the first album to the second is the rest of us. It's the 4 guys that were there for both. Because the difference from us, from Great Shake the Moneymaker Southern Harmony, is unquantifiable. Like, we went from being a band that had a good sense of what we were trying to be and going way beyond that on the road for 2 years and becoming the band that could make Southern Harmony. And then Ed joined halfway through that tour, And I mean, he was like this, you know, he was like this guy with a carrot across the room at all times. Like, hey, look what I'm doing. And we gravitated and tried to catch up and get to his level. But Ed was always great. I mean, he was already there, you know what I mean? And so he played a huge part in getting us there. But the biggest difference in the band is just our confidence, those basic tracks, like the way that album was made. In a weird, you know, like Ed and Mark were hugely important in that, but I mean, they showed up fully formed, you know, if that makes sense. The work was the rest of us who weren't anywhere near that when we started off for Shake the Landmaker. But that said, that band had those two guys jump in and join us, and then that was just like pouring, you know, jet fuel onto a raging fire. I mean, you know, the it's kind of weird to talk about because it's so self-evident, you know, what Mark brought to the band. I mean, Ed had already been there for a year. But then Mark just stepped in, and it just was like this. He just, you know, I don't know, every hole in the boat, he just fixed it, or whatever you want to say, any analogy. He was just, he took everything and just made it better. You know, he took any, and he walked in the first day to play with us, and a lot of the songs were already written. We were already playing them, and it was like, hey, what do you hear here? And like, as soon as he started playing, it just, everything just went up to another level. And it was like, those periods of growth, there was no sliding back. Like, he just put it to a place where, from that moment forward, our worst day, we were still going to be pretty damn good things, you know? And so, and then by the time we were touring on that record, then the ability, his influence and how the band worked in arranging and writing and just all those things, then it really showed itself. But for the making of Southern Harmony, it was more like he was this cherry on top, Mark was. And then he, over the course of that tour, then I feel he blended in and really, then we really got the full impact of what he was able to get for the band.
And we've gone on record to say that tour, in the aftermath of Southern Harmony, High as the Moon, in that era was the strongest, the apex of the Black Crowes.
I think it was the most cohesive, you know. But I think the same thing, I think we had nights in 2010 where the band was as cohesive as it could be. You know, it's a very different band, but it was on the same page. And I think that there was just that, there's that thing on the way up when everything connects and clicks. And the Southern Harmony Tour was that for us. That was where it was all, and it wasn't obvious at the time, because again, you're always looking to the next place. But looking back, you know, and I think anywhere from 92 to 96 is really the, you could take any of those and go, that's kind of hard to beat. But that was when it was all just, like we were still going out every night, like to just, let's go kill this thing. And we were all together. Like there was this sense of we were all trying to get to the same place every night. And it was never quite like that again. I mean, we still had great results, but I'm just totally speaking internally. And the unspoken, you know, communication between everybody was by 93, it was never that fluid again, I should say, I guess.
Yeah, I was 15. I saw my first show at the Tower Theater in Philly in 93 on that tour. Probably why I'm sitting next to you today.
Okay.
You know, and I think the book is really your opportunity to explain all the head scratchers, all the what the hells, all the
some
almost.
Some of them.
I mean, you talked about it being closure. The book has been closure for yourself. It's been closure for people. For the band.
I think it's been, a lot of other people have said that word to me. I don't feel like it was to me, because I feel like I'm already there. The book wasn't a cathartic thing. I didn't have days where I wrote and I closed the laptop and it was like, oh, it's the, I've already gone through all that. You know, I've already had therapy and I've already been processing this in real time and then ever since, you know. So it was more just the grind of getting it all out and putting it down in a way that flowed in the way I see it and felt it. And so But for so many other people, other guys in the band and crew members and managers, all these other people that have contacted me, that's a word that they're using all the time, you know, because I think no one ever left the experience of being in the band in a great place. Like no one ever walked away like, that was great, you know, it just didn't happen. There's not one person that can say that. People left feeling okay, but not great. And there's only a few of those people. And so for everybody that's been looking back and in their own life trying to make sense of it, it's been a pretty, it can be, it's not overstating it to say it's really traumatic for some people, but it's certainly been difficult. And so it's been really rewarding for me to know that it touched everyone. I mean, to me, it's such a personal book. I mean, it's a, the whole book's about me. I mean, you know, in a way, it's like this is me responding a lot of times very poorly, or in, you know, in ways that I would have never could imagine acting now. You know what I mean? It's like this is all about, I'm in this situation, and here's the cast of characters, but this is my path, you know. And so, but so I was surprised that so many other people related and got, you know, that got people that were in the middle of it are all saying virtually the same stuff when I talked to everybody. And I've talked to, I haven't spoken to Mark, we've been in touch, and I've talked to pretty much everybody else who's in the book, not named Robinson. And it's pretty standard across the board, everyone's feelings and thoughts. And it's, but that's been really gratifying to me.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, I really didn't write it for, if I found myself thinking about how's this going to, you know, I just had to stop. I mean, you just, that's just death if you're wondering about how any specific person, much less fans or any large group of people, is going to receive something. I mean, I knew there would be a million different reactions, and I just had to focus on, I'm just writing my story. This is it.
Yeah, but Brian Koppelman on the podcast you were with him said that you made Chris Robinson out to be the worst guy in the world. Mm-hmm. And I'd be inclined to agree that to the portrayal. Did you consider that at all?
No.
In doing it?
No, I mean, that's... I don't see it that way. I don't think he's the worst guy in the world. I think he's a mess. I think he's got some real, you know... But that's a guy that for many years I loved with all my heart, too. You know, and it's just... But again, that came and went, and then the rest, you know, you still look at the... I've had people say at some of these events, they're like, I don't even want to hear the records anymore. And I'm like, oh, yeah, my God. If you do that, then all that's left is the book. You know, like, fuck. It was all... The music is... That's the most important thing. I mean, I didn't have a vendetta, but that said, it's very frustrating to see years and years of a very false narrative being presented, you know, and even that narrative changes depending on the day or the minute or the mood or whatever, and so that's a little frustrating, but it's really, you know, when Ed died, it was in the aftermath of Ed's death where it just suddenly made perfect sense to write this book, like, because Ed died without anybody knowing his story, and I can't tell his story. I wish somebody could, you know, but that's too late. And I did have a sense of, well, shit, I'm not going to not get mine out, you know. And plus, I just think it's a great story. I mean, as much as it's like, some of it really sucks, but man, it's fucking awesome. I dropped out of college, and I bought a drum kit, and got in this crazy good band for 30 years, and doing all this. I mean, it's fantastic.
I don't begrudge you the portrayal. I don't think you were unfair to him or Rich or really anyone. I'm just acknowledging that
no,
there was a perception that you were.
Well,
really
I think that the people, you can tell right away what people's almost always subconscious. They don't, but everyone has a sense of expectation before they open the book. If you're a diehard Crows fan, you're hoping, I hope this gig is in there, or this story, or what's really happened this. And I've talked with enough people where I don't think people are aware of what they're expecting, but they know when they're disappointed. You know, they're like, the fuck, what is this? Or they're pleasantly surprised or whatever. But for people that aren't so involved in the Black Crows, I think their perspective, and I did think, I want this to be a book that someone who doesn't know a thing about the band can still read and relate to. I mean, because it is a universal story. I mean, it's basically, it's friendship and loyalty and betrayal and addiction and codependency and love and hate, and it's all of those. When it was happening, I was always aware of it. Like, man, this is just a novel. It's a movie. It's just all these elements that have always been the building blocks of all every great story ever told. It's just in the context of a fucking rock and roll band, you know. And I didn't want to write a book about rock and roll. I never saw it as like we're just a rock band conquering the world. I never had that sort of cliched view of it. It was far more important to me than that. It was everything. It was my whole life, you know. That's the way everybody was at a certain point. So I think this is the weirdest thing ever, but I've had people, like producer of Squawk Box on CNBC wants me to come on the show and talk about workplace dynamics, and I'm like, you know, and like, they have an event, and they ask me, I don't know, but she's like, well, we get all these CEOs in a room to talk about these themes, and, you know, I think you'd be great at that. And I'm like, uh-huh, okay. She goes, so we'll have the CEO of, like, Delta Airlines and Chipotle and Kaiser Permanente, and I'm like, and you want me to say what? And she's like, no, this is all universal stuff. Like, everybody who's ever worked in any creative field or any really intense, where there's a lot of pressure, can relate to every story in the book. And I always felt that way, but then to hear other people say it, it's like, oh, yeah, shit, of course, you know. So, I mean, there was a lot more in it, and when I was writing it, I was aware of all those. Those are the things that all led me to it as much as anything about just wanting to get something out about the Black Crowes. I mean, it's, you know, the Black Crowes isn't this thing it did. It was me, and it was my friends, and it was the people where, you know, it was very, very, it's kind of weird to put it into those kind of terms. It can sound trite when you say it's my whole life, but that's what it was.
Comes out in the book, and that's what makes it's magical to all of us, and that's what made it so excruciating to read some of the stories in there. We're in San Francisco, and we spend a lot of time talking about Chris's preoccupation with all things Grateful Dead after he went to a show in '91, and there's a conflict in the book where you talk about that era of the band, '92 to '96, which is what was most influenced by his preoccupation with involving set lists and many covers for jamming.
Yeah.
But you also really, it was not to your chagrin, and you feel like...
No, all of which was, I thought all that was great. I think that it just went too far. I mean, I was always good with, I'm not a guy who walks down the middle, and I'm not trying to be the moderate and everything, but I just think that there were very obvious moments where it all clicked and made sense, and everybody could feel it, and we'd be like, oh man, that's the thing. And then to get the next day, it's okay, let's go further. It was like, we just got here, and now everyone's comfortable. And the biggest problem with that to me, because people say all the time, like, that's my favorite period of the band, 97 in Europe. And I'm like, awesome. I mean, you're right. I mean, everyone's right. I'm not running for office. I'm not trying to, if you know, because there's gigs that I was miserable the whole gig. As a drummer, every time I ever walked off stage thinking that I was the love child of Ringo and Buddy Rich, everybody said, man, you had a rough night, huh? And I'd go. And then when I had gigs where I was just fighting the drum kit the whole night, that's when everybody goes, I've never heard you better. You know, so it's like, I go into this knowing my perspective is just mine. So when people love periods of the band or a certain gig or something that I wasn't happy with, I don't say you're wrong. I'm like, great. Because everyone's, you know, and I say, the fans who have all the gigs and listen, they know more about it than I do. I don't listen to that shit. I've never gone back and listened to a live show. I have no interest in it. I can't do it with Trigger Hippie. I don't do it with any, if I play a session, I don't go back and, I'm there, and when it's over, that's for everyone else to do. I just don't like, because I'll just tear myself apart. I'll listen to every little thing and be like, oh, what was I thinking there? I mean, the turnaround on the album version of Sting Me to go back to the second verse, I still hate it, like with all of my life. It's just this little and it's the most pedestrian. In the studio, I knew, I was like, oh, I should do something now, just play on. You know, it's one of those. And that's what's on the record. And I'll never hear that and not go, God damn, I hate that. So why would I go back and listen to gigs? You know what I mean? It's just like, it's pretty brutal. But, no, I was totally down with playing covers. I was totally down with playing new songs we just wrote that day. Totally down with jamming, all of it. There's just a point when we're moving away from the strengths of the band. When you do that to where everyone is at their best and in their, not necessarily comfort zone, but in their strong zone, you know what I mean? Like that was what was going on in 92, 93, 94, 95. By summer 95 and then into 96, 97, it just got way too far out where, and it was still good. I'm not saying we weren't a great band, but it wasn't everybody doing what they did best. And it's like you're playing not to our strengths, but to one person's view that no one else wanted to go with it. You know, we did. And it's a testament to everyone else on that stage that those gigs are what they are. But I think that we missed a great chance to really solidify us doing what we were. The Black Crowes were something by 92. I thought we were the best rock band in the world. And I didn't see any reason to start bringing in elements that were not within the framework of what we had built up and who everybody was. You know, why not work to your strengths? And we were great at writing new songs and playing them. And we were great at learning covers. And we were great at jamming. But within that, the idea that... and it wasn't just... That was a general vibe. That was the band's vibe. We were all trying to accommodate what Chris did. And so, you know, obviously he's a catalyst in those early years. I mean, there's no one saying he wasn't the quarterback of the team, but it's like, yeah, but it's a team. And so if you want to start to do things that everyone else is not happy with, and everyone else is going, hang on, man, that's not us. And his answer was always, so, you know, that's the thing that, and again, the gig could be great that night, but the erosion of the internal confidence we have in each other, that's what that does. That's when the Chinese water torture starts. And the things that connect you that are, you don't even have words for, those are the things that start to erode, and that's when a band starts losing itself, and that's what happened with Black Rose.
And that's explored in depth. It helped us understand a lot of that. Because like I said, there's a lot of head scratchers through the years and the false narratives that were put out there. And now it's almost like we finally get the story.
Well, and it was always, and those things were discussed too. Like there was, I think that, you know, in the early 90s, you know, I think there was a great opportunity for the band to be, well, I mean, in simplest terms, like the guys from the grunge bands that came in after us, they had no problem saying, like, I feel a little weird about this, you know? They didn't have a problem admitting their vulnerabilities and their insecurities and their in over their head with where their careers were. And that was nothing we ever allowed ourselves to do or say. It was like, no, well, we got to always act like we're completely in control and we're doing everything we want. It's not how it felt ever. It was like, why can't we be as confused as anybody else? This is weird. We didn't bargain for all this shit. And so, but then that's, you know, on one hand, by ignoring all that, we turned ourselves into a great band. But then you've got to constantly adapt. And, you know, with every year, every record, every period of time, we were just never able to stop. And there was no such thing as a conversation in that band where, how do you feel? What are you doing? Where do you feel different in the last 6 months? Like, that never happened. Ever. I mean, I didn't want to do it. I mean, it's not like I'm not, that's everybody. We were just not those people. And so, I know, I see younger bands now, and you meet them, and they have like monthly, you know, scheduled, once a month, they turn their phones off and really dig into each other, and I'm like, wow, that would have been great, or horrible, or both. But that was never going to happen in the fucking Black Rose, I can tell you that. Not a chance.
We're going to open it up to the questions from the folks in a minute. I just wanted to get directly from you. You mentioned 2010 is another high point of the group, but you virtually ignore the last 8-ish years, the last third of the band's career.
Well, the narrative was established. I mean, as a story, it's... I wrote more, but then in reading back and figuring out how we wanted to edit it, a lot of it was the names have changed, and that's it. You just put different people in. The vibe, it was the same, but just in certain ways, just darker and worse. I mean, it really was. There was a level of
darker and worse.
Oh, yeah, yeah. The 2008 and 9 and 10 were the angriest internal... It was a nightmare. I mean, I said you say that. It just was the... Yeah. But, you know, in a weird way, everybody was just used to it. You know what I mean? It's like... To step out of it, you know, in my life right now, if I had one conversation with anybody like a normal day in 2009, I mean, there'd be fists flying, you know, and be like, wait a minute, what are you talking about? Or I would just walk away. And at the time, it just got so, it was just normal. And that, and it's, but again, in the grand scheme of the story of the band, that just, nothing was done in those years that ever, I mean, to me, the essence of the band, and a big part of that was once when Mark and Ed left the second time. I mean, and that's not a knock on Luther or Adam, who are great dudes, and I love playing with them. You know, I really did. And I still, I feel great about everyone personally that joined the band. And I do think, I love playing with Paul Stacey. He's one of my favorite guitar players. But and in 2010, that band on good nights was just killing it. You know, we would walk off stage and even then I'd be like, oh man, fuck, that was something. So, again, it was just what it was. But I didn't think after a certain point in the book, it's pretty exhausting. You know what I mean? And I was looking for high points and I was like, well, there really aren't any. I don't have any really exciting, happy things to say about that period. They're just, I mean, I could talk about getting home and going to my kids' preschool. Those were pretty fucking great days. But, you know, I don't think that really fit the narrative of the book, generally speaking.
Do you think if you hadn't written this book, you would have gotten a phone call for this summer?
Oh, God, no. Not a chance.
So the book had nothing to do with it.
Not in the least. No, I mean, Chris wasn't going to call. I mean, look, if Chris had said in 2014 to Rich, let's do a 50-50, Rich would have said, okay. I never thought differently. You know, Chris tried to take his piece too, and so that's when he was like, you know. But that was the, and I don't even begrudge her. I don't care. Like, I genuinely.
I don't care either.
Moving forward has nothing to do with me. It's a shit show, and it's going to be, but they have every right to do it, and they have to do it, and so go. I've said this a million times. If you're in your 50s and you can make a living playing music, then God bless you. And if people want to go to those shows and relive Shake Your Moneymaker, that's awesome. That's still my album, too. I mean, I love when people love the Black Crowes music. But as far as the essence of the Black Crowes, to me, officially and beyond any shadow of a doubt, died when it died. And there was never a chance that I wanted to go back and reconstitute. Because the next question is, well, what if they had called? They wouldn't have. They're not about to split money. And secondly, I would have had no interest, especially in a tour the way they're doing this and with the people they're doing it with. I mean, it's just across the board. When I say it's a shit show, I mean it in every possible level. Not, fuck those guys. Not that at all. It's like, no, this is bad. And it's sad. And it's a shitty thing for the legacy of a once-great band.
It hurts.
And again, but I can hold two thoughts in my head at the same time. They have every right to do it, and if this is what they need to do, then we'll do it. I mean, if it's going to make people, because there are going to be young people who are going to maybe go listen to Shake Your Moneymaker. That's great. That's the whole point, is that the music is going to be around forever. And I think that they could have done things a lot differently over the years, but it's not who they are. It's like asking, you know, it's we were talking, you know, someone said something about there's no, like I said, there's no stopping, pump the brakes. What are we doing? Why are we doing it? How do we want to do this better? That doesn't happen. It did on the first two albums, you know, and we had great people around us and we listened to them. And then that stopped and it never came back. And so they're just where they are. And it's I'm not angry about it. It's sad. It's all, the book's sad. The story's sad. But that said, I'm thrilled that it all happened. I'm filled with gratitude about my life. And this is just a thing that could have been one thing, and it was still pretty great.
It was amazing. Yeah. You still correct.
Yeah, exactly.
All right, let's open it up to some fans, Q&A. Anyone want to ask Steve anything? You don't need this, go ahead.
Hey, Steve.
Hey, man.
Huge fan. I've seen over 60 shows.
Thank you.
And there was a point somewhere in the 2000s, I don't know the dates very well, but started to do a drum solo?
Yeah, not my choice.
I was wondering,
never mind.
Whose idea was that, and how did you feel about it?
I hated every second of it. I never wanted to do a drum solo. It got really bad when they would all leave the stage. I was like, oh, fuck. And that was just to fuck with me, because everybody knew I was like, I would just go like 16 bars and done, and you know, it was always Chris. No, go longer. And I would say like, and he's like, what's wrong with you? I'm like, I'm fine, I can sit here bullshit all day long. No one cares. No, I'm not that kind of drummer. No one's here to see me take a drum solo. Maybe they are, and that's cool, but the vast majority of people, I saw it the same way I saw a lot of the covers we did. No one came to see the Black Crowes play that song. Not one person would be happier with East Carolina Blues than Sometimes Salvation. And if that person's here, someone needs to punch him in the face. There's only one person that wants to hear that song tonight, and he's the singer, and that's why we're playing it. So the drum solo to me was just like that. It's like, no one's buying a ticket. Man, I hope Gorman goes off tonight. I sure as hell didn't want to. You know, and again, it's fine. It's part of it. We're trying things, but it hit a point where I realized, way ahead of everybody else, like, I'm just not that interested in this. You know, so why am I subjecting an audience to it? And, you know, like, so much of the band was these concurrent realities and themes, but, like, I was on the record of saying, like, I thought the recorded version of Golden Hills, I love that. I love the lyric. It was the last authentic lyric Chris ever wrote. And I couldn't believe you wrote it then. I was like, that's actually, you're writing a real song about yourself. And I thought the recorded version was really cool for a B-side. I was like, that's a great lost track that someone finds later. And he's like, no, it's going on the record. And I was like, oh, okay. And then he wants to play it live. And I'm like, oh, man, nobody. No, this is just piss break central. Like, you're just, I mean, I guess on one hand that's nice, but why don't we play something people want to hear? You know, and it's not, I do say in the book, I never had a, I was never obsessed with sales figures and money. You know, we all made a good living. I was not counting tickets or album sales. I was, and I'm not trying to give myself a gold star, but I just looked at the room and I was like, man, it's pretty obvious what our fans want from us. Why are we not giving them that? Why are we forcing them down all these rabbit holes? And then some nights we bring it back around and then it's a euphoric encore. Then some nights not. Like, come on, man, it's not that difficult. So a lot of that kind of stuff. It was like, but that was the band from 93 on. It was always varying threads of great and weird and confusing even on the inside. Yes, sir?
So I never got, can't wait to read the book. I never got the jump from Southern Harmony to Amorica until the Last Crows album came out. And suddenly they were like all these early versions. It's like Amorica got recorded twice.
Yeah.
Like first time, and then everything got beaten up and recorded the second time. And stuff like Feather, which is amazing. Never even made that.
Yeah.
What, like, how do you go about recording the, like, it's expensive.
Yeah.
Like, so going through and doing the whole thing
back then
twice.
Well, we made a record that Chris produced, and it just wasn't that. It just, no one liked it. The label didn't like it. No one else in the band liked it. I mean, it's fine. As an additional bunch of tracks, if you're a fan, you know, when I'm a fan of a band, I'll listen to them talking in the studio. You just want everything. But if you were going to put a third album out following Southern Harmony and it was going to be tall, that was not going to be a good move. Is how everyone felt, and even Chris had to admit that eventually. But there was also a thing where he had a real reticence to, he always wanted records to be new songs, meaning we'd go on tour for a year and a half and we'd write all these great songs, and then we'd get off the road and he'd say, no, we need all new songs for the record. He always had this, which no band, that doesn't make sense. Like, I was always a proponent of, and I wasn't alone in this, you just take a day off and go record a track. I mean, that's where Led Zeppelin 2 came from. That's where all the Stones albums, all the bands we love, they don't block off 6 months and go make a record. They just do it. You do it piecemeal. When you have enough songs you dig, that's the next album. And that has a natural, healthy flow. And so the development, you don't confuse your fans that way. And I think there was a lot of songs between Southern Harmony and Amorica that were a wonderful bridge that were just lost along the way. And then it happened again, and it happened all the time. There was always tons of material that was just left behind. As B said, the head scratching moment. So. Plenty of those.
The other side of that coin, and that's a great one. It's great in the book. He explains that period of time of fail by effort. You do it again, and it banned the second album that you put in that came out.
It was the, for, in the context of having just pulled, you know, like there's a lot of getting ourselves up out of the ditch at the last possible minute. That was the greatest example of that ever. I mean, the band that. The Black Crows in February of 97, when we finished the European tour, was just completely dead and broken and I mean, down for the count. And then a month and a half later, we get back together and go record this record. It was supposed to be demos, and we thought it was an album once we recorded it. That was the most staggering, where did this come from moment we ever had. And I think those tracks still hold up. I mean, I think that stuff's great. And it's the songwriting, too. Suddenly those lyrics were really, they were real about Chris's life. He tended to go, he got more and more removed from writing about himself. Like, we had a song called Bewildered, and for the third album, he's like, it bums me out to sing it. And I'm like, well, then you shouldn't have fucking written it, because it's great. Sorry, it's sad for you, but you wrote it, and it's great, so let's go. I haven't heard a lyric from him. I've missed a lot, clearly, but I think by the time, but band was the last real sense of, in hindsight, to me, where he was really writing from his heart. And I think that it speaks for itself. Those songs are fantastic. And he and Rich together, just like bringing songs into the room saying, we've got an arrangement done, and here's the lyrics, and here's a melody, and that was the last time they ever did that for real.
I think that it's a good book. Thanks for the book, man.
Thank you.
That was a lot of work. And so, you know, for me, I hear the tension of the friendship, actually. It's heartbreaking, really. It's a tension.
Yeah,
there's no question.
Well, that's 100% what it was,
yeah.
I mean, to start off with. And I mean, to my, a fault of mine looking back with all the best intentions is if anybody joined the band, I was just, by God, they're on my team. Like, you know, I dropped every wall. Like, no, if you're here, you're here. Let's go. Like, I took everything like that. Those tensions and the friendship thing is really... And by the way, every member of the Black Crowes has stories about me being the biggest prick they ever met. That's all true. I mean, I, you know, you don't remember when you say something that you think's funny and someone else gets their feelings hurt, especially when they don't tell you. But, you know, 2 years after the fact, well, that time you said this, and I'd be like, what? You know, like, there's a lot of those moments, right?
I mean, like 21, right, Steve? I mean, you're growing up together.
Yeah, and I a lot of my trash talk and having the last word, I mean, I have five older brothers. That's just natural for me. I came up in that. And in my mind, it was always, it was never declarations of war. It was always, oh, I'll spar, we're sparring? Oh, great, let's go. Other people didn't see it like that. They could start it, but then if it got to a point, then it was like a real, this is a real problem or a fight. And then, of course, we never discussed it, got past it, and just everything just sat there forever. But the problems, you know, no one in that band ever looked at me and was like, I can't believe my drummer's doing it. I'm Steve, you know. Chris isn't the singer in the Black Crowes. It's the guy I used to loan money to. He was my best friend. And Johnny, you know, that's my dude. And we did all these things together outside the band that really solidified us. And then he would have a weird day. And you don't look at it like, it was never, why is my guitar player an asshole? It was like, why is Rich, what's wrong with you? It's just, you know, in my mindset, it was always us against the world. And it's like, for real, like that really is, in any band you have, you know, bands don't have to be best friends, but you have to respect each other. I mean, I know plenty of things about a lot of bands that have been around a lot longer than the Black Crowes, and those fucking guys hate each other's guts, but they respect each other, and they recognize the importance of their place and what they all give. And that, but those lines were just totally crossed all the time. And so, yeah, it was never, I mean, it can be annoying, and it's like the Amorica, I talk about the Amorica cover, which I thought was ridiculous and still do. That's a decision that, like, why is the singer of the band doing this? But I didn't go home and lose sleep over it. But when someone betrays your confidence or betrays your trust, or, you know, then it's personal, and that has nothing to do with the band. That's just people shit, you know. The Rich Jimmy Page thing, which is the most, you know, that's got nothing to do. The absurdity of that is it's a people story. Who would look at the guy that just gave us our career back and say no? That's that story to me. We would have never made a record with Jimmy Page. He wasn't going to do that. He wanted to, but for a million reasons, it probably wouldn't have worked out. Or even if it had, maybe it worked, maybe it didn't. It's not a question of what did we miss. Like, did the sword come out of Excalibur from Page one last time? That's not the point. It's this guy just gave us our life back, and he's offering to help more. And the answer is yes, thank you. That's the answer.
Thank you for bringing that to life. Now it makes...
Yeah.
You know, since 3, I ended up in second row shoreline ticket.
That would have been a great show.
Oh, yeah.
You and me both. So, yeah. I was there and I was screaming every night. That was fucking great!
Yeah, I often wonder why that didn't come. Because
yeah.
You kind of knew Jim Page hurt his back, yeah, and something else must have happened for that to just be dropped.
Well, he was, you know, the other thing too, again, just on, it's about people. He was more than willing to continue in tremendous pain. And I, you know, we didn't realize how bad he was until he had a day where he felt better. And that's when it was like, oh my God, this is really bad. Because suddenly he had one day after this guy worked on him in LA where he was just like, oh, and you could see the relief. I mean, he immediately looked 5 years younger.
Yeah.
And it was like, dude, shit, this is bad news, whatever. And I don't even know exactly what the problem was. It's a disc of some, I don't know if it was upper or lower or whatever.
You all have
that. Yeah, trust me. And so, but I know that, you know, again, it went from, but I also don't know what was happening before that. If he was already a little, you know, he really, and I'm not throwing more dirt in Rich's face, but he was really had fun playing off with Chris. And Rich didn't perform. You know, Rich doesn't perform, ever. He's on stage, he's in his own head. He doesn't really give a lot performance-wise, and he never gave Jimmy. You know, Jimmy would come over and he would just look at him and And I'm like, Rich, smile back. We're playing in my time of dying. Smile. But it just didn't happen. And so, you know, I'm like, well, who knows what Jimmy, but I don't know. But all I know is that, you know, at that point in time, I said the biggest pulling ourselves out of the ditch for the Black Crowes was Band. But the Jimmy Page thing was, I mean, in the fall of 99, I mean, honestly, there was nothing. Record labels wouldn't even answer Pete's call. And then we played 6 gigs with Jimmy, and we had an offer from every label in the world. The next summer was cool, though, just because we were grooving more. That's the only difference. I mean, you can never get that initial excitement back. Those LA shows were... The last night at the Greek was... That really was like the ultimate just head mind-blowing experience. And fucking, you know, Richie Hayward was there, and Mike Mills from R.E.M. was there, and I was just like, this is fucking great. It's pretty exciting. Yeah, no, that was good. That next summer, we were grooving then.
Yeah. Are you going to be bringing Trigger Happy out here?
Yeah, sometime this year. Probably not till the fall. We're just, we're happy to be east of Mississippi for a while.
That Jimmy Page and the Black Crowes, the live album, that is probably... That and Live and Leave, those are two of the best records. I can't believe I didn't get a speed ticket listening to the Greek Theater on that. That album, you just put that down and crank it and drive. It's unbelievable, the thunder that came out of that record. It's such a great, great live record.
Good.
I was curious, when you guys, there's a point in the book where you talk about how Rich kind of, you guys are having faith on making set lists, or Chris is making the set list. You can tell the energy's going down. Rich does a set list and it just goes through the roof.
Right.
Moving forward through the years, was there any more who contributing set list wise, was everybody just kind of content to let one or the other, or did it?
Well, no one's content. It was just, you know, at a certain point, you're talking to the wall. It's just, you know, there was, it's so funny too, because I was always amazed at the narrative of this band being presented, and Chris's vision is to just be this band that can go anywhere at any time. If we walked out the set list, anybody that's seen a bunch of shows, very, very rarely did we ever deviate from it.
Right.
And I mean, like, there would be an obvious vibe in the room, and then you'd be playing, and I'm just looking down, I'm like, oh, here comes fuck, you know, some Last Place That Loves Lives or something, and I'd be like, oh, but yo, man, what's up?
It was like, no,
that's on the list. That's what we're doing.
We should do some of these people, I'm sure, in the room too, and do like a whole, if you guys did 6 nights at the Fillmore,
yeah,
and so many nights the set list would change radically,
yeah, right,
which was great to have that ability. It made the show so much more fun.
Sure.
What are we going to hear tonight?
Yeah.
But you would always wonder at what point in the show, after you just rock out hearing something, that something really strange would come on.
Yeah.
In the
moment at the time, you know, for a long time it was always everything. Everybody got angry about every little thing, and at some point, you know, at least for me, I did realize, like, well, this is just what it is. I mean, it's not. I mean, Chris didn't wake up and think, "How am I going to fucking piss off Steve today?" Actually, that's not true. Yeah. But not every day. There were times when he did. Just like I did about him. I'd wake up and think, I know how I can really get under his skin today, and this will be fun. I mean, that's such, that's, again, that's normal. That just happens. But it was just a, I think there was, I think if you admit what you're great at to him, that was some sort of a surrender, or a, then there's pressure, you know? It's, stay ambiguous, and then nobody can pin you down. And I think that's about that's his view on life, you know. That, and the Black Crowes and everything he does, it all suffer from that. But that's not suffering to him. He thinks that's what it is. So it's a very different thing. When I first met Chris, we were talking about basketball, and he said his favorite player ever was Quentin Daly. And if Google Quentin Daly, I should have walked away that right then. What? The guy from the Bulls that's in prison for rape? That's your favorite player ever? Phew, man, he was great. And I told him I love Magic Johnson. He goes, oh, why? I'm like, oh, I don't know. Greatest point guard of all time. But I mean, it really is, like I said, it wasn't by design. But when you're young, you do think everything's like, come on, you know, everybody thought everybody else would one day wake up and just start making sense. Right. They thought I would, everybody in the band, there was things I was doing, I'm sure. I don't know what they are, but now Steve will come around one of these days. You know, you spend all these years waiting for everyone to get into your headspace. And then one day you realize, like, the only thing I can control is me. And I still want to be here, but I just got to try to figure out my own head and just see what happens. Those Fillmore runs were awesome.
Yeah, I got to find it.
There's some great shows, man. Fantastic.
Because I've been there since 1991.
I know that. I've seen you 1,000 times. I've never told this story publicly. The night before the Warfield, my cousin and I, Jeffrey, who later was the Dancing Crow, but he was on the road with us then. We went out to see the A's play the Orioles and got rip-roaring drunk on stadium beer, as you do. And we were waiting at the bar to come back, and we're just out of our minds. And I'm like, man, I gotta take a leak. He goes, yeah, me too. And we're looking around, and it's bad, and we're really stupid drunk. And we walked to the very end of the platform and just peed into a trash can. And I'm standing there just like, oh my God. And I just hear this. There's just two Oakland cops, and they're standing right next to us. And he goes, no, go ahead, finish. And we finished, and just picture that, two guys peeing in the trash can, so ridiculous. And he goes, so why wouldn't we arrest you right now? And he said some of that effect, and I was like, man, and Jeffrey goes, man, he is in a band, we're playing tomorrow, the Black Crow. I'm like, dude, I'm like, that's the last thing I can say. And I was like, no, I'm not in a band. And he goes, which is it? And I was like, I'm in a band. He goes, what band? I said, the Black Crows. He goes, oh, okay. All right, this is your one. Get on the train, literally. And I got on the train, and I was like, my God. Anyway, that's the Warfield story I have. So back to the Fillmore.
But to have you guys come and play that first run at the Fillmore for me was like,
yeah.
I was in heaven. I mean, I'm surrounded by family, literally.
That in 2005? That one in 2005?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was incredible. Yes. That was
huge,
great.
Huge musical family. Yeah. You know, faces.
Oh, I remember very, very well, like, that vibe. That was, that's one of those things. It was obvious right there, like, the whole week. We did have a shit, the last night, like, I remember one of those nights, I went around the corner to that Starbucks, and there's a girl, a woman, from East named Denise, I just remember, you know, and she walked up and said, hey, can I buy your coffee for you? And I said, sure. And she was like, and she took it, and I'd seen her at a bunch of shows, and she goes, thanks so much for doing this. And I was like, well, yeah. And she's like, no, really, this is, I don't know if you guys are aware, but this week is what everybody's been waiting for, you know, she spelled it out. I said, no, I do feel that. And I remember, like, going back to the gig, just like, man, this is amazing that we have this chance. Like, this is actually happening again. And this isn't in the book, I think. It's not in there. I wrote it. But, you know, and again, I'm just saying this to point out, it's just, you could never get away from it. The last show of that run, we did an encore and then left, and then nobody would leave. So we went back and did another encore, and nobody would leave. And we went to the dressing room right downstairs, and the lights came up and nobody left. And we're still sitting there like, man. And so we were like, let's go do another one. And Chris is like, no, I'm not doing it. And we're all, and the whole band, and Pete and Amy, everyone's like, dude, just go give one more. And we said, let's go play Sometime Salvation. If we play that right now, the roof will literally blow off the floor. And he was like, he just took his shoes off. He goes, no, I'm not letting them fucking tell me what to do. And it was like, but it was also, but it did, I did realize, like, oh, he literally can't help this. Like, it's not, that's not him being an asshole. That's a guy who's just, fuck, it's just a mess, you know? And it's like, motherfucker, it's just that simple. It's right there. Because if we had done that, we played it, I think, the first or second night, and this was the very last night. We hadn't done a lot of repeats. And if we had gone out with that vibe right then and played that one song, that was the only song anyone suggested. Everybody goes, that's the one, let's go. And I mean, even Ed is like, oh man, that's the one, about, you know, we're all like, let's go. And it just couldn't happen. Just couldn't let it ever just be okay, you know? And again, that's just, it's sad. It's just those moments. And I don't mean to take away from the great week you already have, but it's just, that's the kind of thing where it was, you know, to me, after all this time, I mean, it's mind-boggling to me it lasted half as long as it did.
those.
I remember that morning song from the one that was in the DVD.
Second
build up. Build up. Breakdown was like 36 minutes long. But like that same night, I remember it, when it was really going and going, like Chris looking back at me, and we were both just laughing, like, holy shit, when is this going to go? You know, so we did. So, I mean, again, we had all those moments too. I mean, it was just the whole shooting match at all times.
You almost didn't make it back for the 05, 06. I saw a show that you didn't play drums at. What was that like, the negotiating for you to come back? It was kind of what you never thought about.
Well, that was, it was no big deal. I didn't want to. I mean, I thought that was similar to what's going on right now. I just saw it as they don't know what else to do, and it didn't feel genuine. And the reason I felt that was because it was Pete who called, not even one of them. And Pete and I are still close. And I said, Pete, the fact that you're making this call. And he's like, and he goes, I told them, don't call it. Like, they'll fuck it up. And I'm like, well, if they're going to fuck it up, then they're going to fuck it up. You know, it's just not cool. But then the more time went on, and I this is all in the book, but I mean, Johnny was actually the one who really put it in my head. He's like, man, you better be real honest with yourself. Like, if there's a side of you that's going to be bummed if you don't go back, you've got to at least acknowledge it. And so that was a definite, my mind was telling me one thing, like, I know this movie, I know how it ends. And I was right, and I did know how it was going to end. But I still had this thing, like, well, maybe we can do it right this time, you know, and I just really wanted that to be the case. But then when they went out and were playing shows without a drummer, I just thought it was gonna be fucking great. I mean, nothing against that guy. I knew more than anybody what that experience was going to be like for everyone on that stage. Because I had said I'll come back, and then they were like, no, we're good, we got someone. You know, they're playing their game and all that. I didn't hold out to play a game, I really didn't. I was very honestly just late to coming around to admitting to myself that I wanted to do it. And then they were like, no, we're good. And so it was
they weren't good.
No. I knew that was going to be the case, and I'm not going to act like I didn't have it. Love that little month of schadenfreude, just sitting there like, yeah, it's pretty cool, isn't it, guys? Yeah, it's all about you. But when I did go back, I didn't think twice. I mean, I went back and was like, I'm here. Like, this is it. If we're doing it, let's fucking do it. You know?
You captured Blaine in the battle second time in 05.
By that fall of 05 was fucking crazy. We did the tower in 05. That's the first time we played Fearless. I remember that being like the only really. I had two things that were really emotional to write, and the ending was that. And I don't mean the whole epilogue, but the very ending, like that. And that's like a bad movie scene, but I was struck. I was just started writing, and I was really blocked, and it took me a couple weeks to realize I don't know how it's going to end. And I was like, I gotta know the ending before I can write to it. Like, I needed to set that goal. And I mean, this sounds such a, like, I make it up. I just popped awake at like 3 a.m. and I just, like, saw it, the whole thing about the headstone and all that. And I just got out of bed and I sat in the chair and I opened my laptop and I typed that thing out just like that. And then I was like, I think that's it, okay. And then I went back to sleep, and I got up in the morning and I read it, and I just bawled my eyes out. I mean, I just, wow, and it was really surprising. But I knew that was it. I was like, oh, that's what I'm trying to say. That's what this whole thing is.
Was there a thing where a bunch of your tour bus drivers all died or committed suicide or something crazy?
No, one did.
I thought it was like a spike.
No, one killed himself in an especially horrific way.
That's the part I remember. Yeah. It's especially horrific, but I remember going, was that like a theme of your tour bus driver?
No.
I was telling all these stories about that person. And
yeah,
that
he, thing, so. He cut his own head off with a saw.
That's exactly what
with
I remember.
With a band, like an electric
that,
saw.
Like that. Yeah.
Oh,
it's insane.
Wow.
Yeah, that's a true story.
That's why I didn't mention that part.
Well, you know, people are wondering.
I just wanted to make sure.
He was a driver on the Shake Your Money Maker tour, a guy named Don Register. So, of course, his nickname was Cash. And a really flamboyant character, and just a funny guy, you know. But then we had any band that tours, the bus drivers are all shithouse crazy in the best way, usually. And then you get a few who are actually really dark and struggling. But we had a guy named Cowboy, on Southern Harmony, and he had been he spent the Vietnam War riding choppers into hot zones and pulling out casualties, and so he was bus driving to him was reliving that. He was getting his boys from A to B every night, like it was his mission. And if there was a problem with that, I mean, he was like at war every night. It took a while for us to pick up on that, you know, but there's a lot of honor in how he approached that, and a lot of sadness, and a lot of, you know, and there's just so many. It's funny, I mean, I haven't thought about this, but every driver has just got they've got their own amazing lives and stories, and they're just surviving in that world for way longer than the bands, you know. Those are all the guys who, you know, and Don, we had a bunch of drivers on Shake Your Mind until we got to Don. Like, every tour was a different driver. And, but, you know, you think like, oh, you've got us now. Now you've got a real band. And they're looking at us like, you'll be gone next year. You know, they've all been doing it for years and years, you know. But the bus drivers, we had a guy, and Lions tour, we had a couple, that guy named Boot and Angie, they were an old married couple. And she sat up with it. He was Ernest Tubbs' drummer and bus driver for years. This old guy who, and he was the best. We were driving across Montana, like a whole, we went from like somewhere in the Dakotas all the way to Seattle. So it's like 2 days on the bus. And I remember watching a Family Feud marathon on the Game Show Network on DirecTV. Richard Dawson, 70s, Family Feud. We're just stoned laughing for 12 straight hours. And he said, and Angie was driving, and Hoot came back, and he pulled out a crock pot, and he goes, I'm going to make some chili. And we're all saying, oh, that's great, Hoot. He's putting on, he's got the cube, he'd already bought all the supplies, and he's putting it all in there, and he goes, well, we'll have good chili in about 6 hours, boys. This will be a real dinner. We won't have to pull over. And we're just all like, this is great. And Andy Hess was playing bass with us at the time, and he came walking out of the back, and he goes, oh, you making chili? And he goes, I sure am. He goes, what kind of beans do you use? And Hoot goes, I didn't say I was making f***ing stew. I said I was making chili. Just so like, wait, what? Just like, he goes, you don't put beans in chili. Yeah, if you want beans, you have beans. And it was just this thing. And it was like, it was so odd and off and hilarious and perfect in the middle of nowhere in Montana. We just all, and again, you just laugh for 2 hours. Like, what the hell is this guy's doing? Yeah. Anyway, yeah, there's a whole book about bus driver stories somewhere.
You mentioned there were two points of writing the book that were emotional. What was the other one?
Oh, Sven flaming out when at the end in the spring of 2000. That chapter was impossible to write. Sure. And I think I'd never, because he and I never really talked about it. We never went through, like, he fell off the face of the earth when he left. And, you know, that's a guy that I had moved to Atlanta. That he was in my first band. You know, Sven was the guy I moved to Atlanta and started a band with. And he had already gone through so much in the early 90s with his first, you know, with the band after I left Miramar Hope. And he was in a band called Needle, and they were all messed up. And when he came back to the Crows, he just kind of got his shit together. And then within a few years, he was off the rails again. And it was terrible to see. And then when he unwound and left the band, like, no one heard from him for years. I mean, he literally just went off the grid. And so when I came back to the band in 05, I knew he was back, but I hadn't talked to him or heard from him. I hadn't seen him in 5 years. And I got back that first, like 5 years and a month, you know, because he left on April 1st, 2000. And so it's like May of 2005. And I got back to Atlanta, and the first time I saw him, you know, it's just, and he, you know, right away, he looked healthy, you could tell. Like, oh, he looks great. And he was so happy I was back. I mean, he more than anybody had been going through a month of shows with another drummer that everyone's riding hard and having trouble with. And so he was so happy. But beyond that, I just said, like, that first day, I was like, man, are you okay? He goes, yeah, I am. I was like, I'm so happy for you. He goes, yeah, thanks. And we never talked about it. We just, because it was, he's good and I'm good and let's just go forward. And so he's the only person I called before it came out to say, hey, I need to talk to you about this thing I just wrote. Because he's a very private person, and I don't know how much of that story anybody else has heard, but it, you know, it was the most heartbreaking thing in real time that happened to me when I was in the band. And and that's a totally personal thing, because he flames out with Clint, and those are my two guys that I first started playing music with, and then I saw Clint the last night I was in town. Like, the timing of all that was so significant in my life. That was like such a huge few days in to me. And so writing it, like, the more I got into it, I kept having to stop and just like, oh my God, like I just had never, that was the only thing I hadn't actually processed, I guess. And so when I finished writing that chapter, I did like finish, like there was a thing, I sat there, and then I went upstairs and I read it to my wife. I said, hey, just listen to this. And I read it and I couldn't read it. I started and I kept crying. It's because it was just so, I just had never admitted how sad I was at the time. It was just like this buried thing. Everything else I'd already dealt with and already faced and talked about and thought about and really mulled over. But that was, for whatever reason, I just never did. And so that was, that at the very end were the two things that I that kind of killed me, right? But everything else was just, this is what it was. And I called Sven and said, you know, or I texted him. I said, hey, I need to talk, you know, I wrote a book. He was like, oh, yeah, I know. And then he was actually going to be in Nashville, like, the next week. So we got together. He was great. He goes, I don't care what you write. It's all true. He goes, if you write something about me, I did it. It's on me. Don't worry about it. I totally trust you. And I was so relieved because I really, it was after the point where it was, there was no going back. And if he had said, I really don't want it in the book, I probably would have taken it out. He's the only, that's the only thing I would have done that for. But he was like, nah, man, go ahead, it's fine. And I gave him an advanced copy. And like, he kind of blasted through it. He goes, yeah, it's about what it was. And I was like, whew. Yeah.
The most emotional part of the book for me as a fan was the end of the golden era of the band that impromptu intervention backstage with Mark, who like loved Mr. Spaceman or something. And,
yeah.
And it was interesting because you spent a lot of time portraying the personalities of each band member, and then they all sort of revealed themselves in that crisis. It was excruciating to read,
yeah.
The way that happened for Mark. But in that, you really see how much of a stand-up dude Johnny Colt is. And you make the statement that sticks with me in the book that, quote, Johnny Colt won in Black Crowes.
Yeah.
What did you mean by that?
He's the only guy who left with, or he's the first. I mean, I felt great when I left in 2001, but it was like that was only because I'd seen him do it. I mean, he spent the summer of 96 and the summer of 97 sober in that band, which is just, it's unimaginable, and just kept to himself. And he wasn't being given an ounce of respect about what he was trying to do for himself. I did. I certainly didn't give him any shit. But, you know, after the recording of Three Snakes, when that was just taken from him, and then getting just piled on for his final year, like, his thing was, it, you know, it was so obvious to him, like, I got to get out of here, but I'm going to get my shit together first, you know. And watching him walk that walk, I mean, that was like a guy trying to lead a gang, just getting your ass kicked in order to get to the door, you know, for real. It was incredible. And I, you know, and then when he did quit, like, I was so stunned, even though I knew it was coming. I mean, I had no doubt in my mind it was going to happen. I still couldn't believe it happened. And that was such a wake-up call to me. It just like, well, I got to get my shit together now. But,
so
but
he
just...
Quit, right?
Not at that moment. We had talked, well, in 95, I said, there's a whole thing about the breakout of the money, and I said, I'm leaving, you know, and Johnny said, well, if you go, I'll go. I mean, he told me, he backed me on that. And then when we made Three Snakes, and then Rich decided he was going to play bass, and Chris said, yeah, that's cool. Like, that's, you know, like I look now, like that's, that whole story is about me not saying, no, stop. And it wasn't like I was stabbing Johnny in the back, you know? That's his fight. That's not my fight. The thing, even beyond that, the thing that I'm most disappointed in myself is that it wasn't about Johnny's feelings. That was the band. That was the essence of what made that band great, was us all playing together. I mean, Johnny's not my favorite bass player. You know, Rich is not my favorite guitar player. Chris is hardly my favorite singer. But together, that's what mattered. You know what I mean? I'm no one's favorite drummer. On our own, like, you know, you could pick apart everybody's playing or singing or whatever, but when everybody was together in a room, that there was a thing that would happen. That was the Black Crowes to me. That's how I always saw it. And so, not drawing a line in the sand for Three Snakes, you know, that's what I let down the Black Crowes more than Johnny. I let down my version of what made that band special.
That choice would basically be the end.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, no, that was it. That was the end of it. It was the beginning of the end, or the end of the beginning, whatever way you want to look at it.
indeedy. Gotta say, what an honor and a privilege it was to have Steve Gorman sit down and rap about his career and his book and the tortured genius, codependence, and what might have been that was the Black Crowes. Now, I'm not going to touch on this whole Brothers Reunion thing. I'm going to go golden rule with it. If you listen to the interview, it's clear how I feel, and I'm not going to check it out. But I don't begrudge anyone who wants to go hear the brothers play the songs with whatever band they're putting together. But I can put a period at the end of the sentence, much like Steve. No Steve, no Crowes for me. And this has been the only episode out of 27 of the Upful Life podcast where I've played exclusively the music of the guest. I did that in tribute out of total respect. And just the fact that I'm not sure Steve's going to really be into any of the other kind of stuff that I would throw down. And, I wanted to keep it focused and keep it Crowes in case any folks were just checking this out as Crowes fans and not necessarily fans or listeners to this show. So any new listeners out there and any listeners in general, thank you for tuning in to the Upful Life podcast. Please feel free to send feedback to b.getz at upfullife.com, UPFULLIFE. That's b.getz at upfullife.com. Even better, you could rate and or review the podcast on iTunes, tell a friend, share it on social, whatever it is. We appreciate you. And shout out to the Stricklands, Lauren and Tucker, who won the tickets to VI Jam Fest. And we're going to wrap things up here with one more jam from the Black Crowes. You guessed it, for the Vibe Junkie Jam of the Week. It's a tough call. I played a bunch of my tunes already, special versions. Right now you're hearing one of my favorite songs, Wiser Time, from Essen, Germany, in November of 96. Really touched on the glory days, as we talked about in the interview, the 90s. The Mark Ford, Johnny Colt, Eddie Harsh era, Southern Harmony through Three Snakes in the Further Tour. And hopefully we'll get to have Steve come back on the show and I can really get into the nitty and gritty with him. But I think he did a great job of doing that. And if you are curious, as I mentioned, there are a number of great Steve Gorman interviews on podcasts of all different kinds. The search function is your friend. So for the Vibe Junkie Jam of the Week, I'm going to play Descending, found on the album Amorica, which really is my favorite Crowes album. I love Southern Harmony with all my heart, and I also love Three Snakes and One Charm. I mean, I love Tall and Band, the albums that never came out from that era. But Amorica was the record that I got as a kid that just took me to the next level. And I've been a fan of the Crowes since I played Jealous Again at my Bar Mitzvah. That's a true story. So, yeah. Amorica was my shit. Remains my shit. One of my all-time favorite records. Any band, any genre. So we're going to wrap it up with the album version. Because, I played live music this whole pod. All these different great live Crowes shows. So we're going to wrap it up with Studio Descending. Shout out to my man J.A. And all my peeps in the Black Crowes, the Taller squad. Thank you for keeping the flame alive, even though this band is fucking embarrassing sometimes. But as I stated earlier, the music does the talking, loudest, longest, proudest, and most profoundly. So, love y'all. Up for Life podcast, episode 27. I'm your host, B. Getz. Holler at your boy, Descending. Amorica. We'll see you next time.
I will.